Good evening. Welcome. I'm Ken Tadashi-Oshima, Chair of Japan Studies here at the University of Washington, and it's wonderful to see such a great crowd on such a beautiful evening. I know it's one of the best nights out, so you are definitely dedicated to come to our Mitsubishi lecture series. And to introduce our speaker, I'd like to ask Dr. Jeff Redinger, Vice Provost of Global Initiatives here at the University of Washington.
Well, let me echo the welcome to the University of Washington and how delighted we are to see you on what is truly a beautiful night, but it's a tribute to our guest speaker that in returning to his alma mater, that he would bring this spectacular weather with him. I want to start this evening's event by acknowledging Honorable Consul General Masahiro Omura of the Consulate General of Japan here in Seattle, who's been a great, great friend of Japan Studies at the University of Washington and a great friend of the University of Washington, and also his staff who are here this evening. I'd also like to acknowledge my good friend and colleague, Robert Bob Stacey, Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, who is also joining us this evening, as are a number of his colleagues. But in particular, I want to acknowledge the generosity of the Mitsubishi Corporation and Mr. Shinichiro Kawasoe, Vice President of Mitsubishi Corporation of America, General Manager of the Seattle Branch, and all of his staff. Without their support of Japan Studies at the University of Washington, we wouldn't be here this evening. It is their continuing support that has created this opportunity for a remarkable lecture series. For those of you that have been following it, we are in the second year of this lecture series, and tonight marks the second of three lectures during this, during 2015. So part of my job is not only to thank you for being here for tonight's remarkable event, but to give you a preview of coming attractions. On the 28th of May, we will welcome Ryosei Kokubon, President of the National Defense Academy of Japan, who will deliver a talk entitled Rising China and Japan's Future, Seeking a Way to Coexist. So we hope very much that you will join us in a few weeks for that talk. At this time, finally, I want to introduce Marie Ancordegai, who is a professor of international studies at the Henry M. Jackson School of International Studies and past chair of the UW Japan Studies Program, and she will introduce our guest speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. It's a great honor and pleasure to introduce Mr. Yoshihiko Miyauchi, Senior Chairman of the Orix Corporation. Mr. Miyauchi was a founding member in 1964 of the company that we now know as Orix Corporation. This was a startup, and it pioneered the idea of leasing equipment to Japanese factories. It has since expanded into a huge corporate group. It leases ships and aircraft, it rents cars, it is in the renewable energy business, venture capital, life insurance, real estate, finance, and development. Mr. Miyauchi became a director of this Orix Corporation in 1970 and was appointed chairman and CEO in 2000. He has a bachelor's degree from Kwansei Gakuin Daigaku, or University in Japan, and an MBA from here, the Foster School of Business at UW. He's the author of many books. It was very interesting to look on Amazon.Japan to find out his many books on management, the leasing business, and most recently a book on taking good risks, in which he encourages Japanese entrepreneurs to be more risk takers than risk avoiders. Mr. Miyauchi appears regularly in major media outlets in serious discussions about how Japan's business system needs to change. He served as the president of a cabinet-level council on regulatory reform and is very active in Keidanren, Japan's biggest the most powerful business organization. He is a major advisor and role model to entrepreneurs and is on the board of several different firms in Japan, including Dream Incubator Incorporated, which specializes in funding startups in Japan and Asia more broadly. He's often referred to as Mr. Deregulation in Japan and is one of the major agents of change in Japan's corporate world. We appreciate very much his willingness to fly all the way from Japan to share his thoughts with us at his alma mater in a talk titled Change in Japanese Entrepreneurship, the Case of the Orix Corporation. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Miyauchi.
ただいまご紹介に預かりました宮城でございます。Thank you very much for the kind introduction, Professor Oshima, Jeffrey and Mary, and ladies and gentlemen. I'm very, very happy to be back here in, at the University of Washington by the invitation, kind invitation of this lecture series sponsored by the International School of International Studies and donation from Mitsubishi Corporations. Always when I come back to the United States, especially to Seattle, I remembered the first time I crossed the Pacific, taking 2 weeks on the boat. That sounds very elegant, cruising life. But back in 1958, that was for the cheapest way to cross the Pacific, taking a 10,000 ton vacant freighter and one of the two passengers they took on the boat. So at that time, Japan and the US, difference is so big for the young student, just finished undergraduate in Japan, going to go US is like going to go paradise. So to me, everything I saw in Seattle and at the University of Washington was so fresh and so really eye-opening of the young student. But study was really hard. I had to study very hard. And what I did was I made a circle in between the dormitory room and a small seat at the library and classroom. This triangle is the entire world for me for the coming 2 years. But gradually, I enjoyed studying. And 2 quarters later, I found out I could apply the foreign student scholarship. And I was granted tuition-free as a tuition-free student. And better than that is that they repaid my tuition already paid previously back in my pocket. That was the biggest money I have ever had at that time. So it's the generosity of the US people or University of Washington. I did not pay any tuition to the university, but I could get a degree, thankful to the maybe a good professor, they try to teach this young student and try to open their eyes to the facing that Japan is a small country and the world is so large. Another episode I have is when I came to, I took the boat. That boat, first port of call was Vancouver. So that I had to get a visa from Canadian embassy. So I first time I went to the Canadian embassy and they have a huge waiting room for the guest. I waited and I found out that the world map is in front of the guest room. And that world map is quite different from I used to see at the schools in Japan. And I gazed carefully and found out this world atlas center of the world atlas was Canada. That was really a surprise to me. And Japan, I have some difficult time to find out where the Japan located. So it is a very, very interesting experience to me. Recently, I visited Australia, and they have also their own world atlas, everything is upside down, and Australia is in the center. So unless you don't be exposed to the wider world, your entire world is remain in a small spot. So I think my studied in the U.S. for the 2 years to really have a hard study was that is maybe changed my entire lifestyle and also my view to the world. Upon coming back to Japan, I got a job at one of the trading firms and worked there roughly 3 years, and they founded a small venture business in Japan, and together with two other trading firms and five banks. Those shareholders are marvelous big companies, but they put up very, very small amount for this venture business. Paid up capital is 100 million yen. That is equivalent to the 1 million US dollars today's price. And they seconded 13 members from each member shareholding companies, and I was assigned, seconded from those trading companies as the youngest staff of the companies. I was sent to the San Francisco to learn how to run the equipment leasing companies. First, I spent three months there, and I came back. Then the company started, and I was a teacher of the how to run the operate leasing companies. I'm the youngest, and I'm also the teacher to the senior people. So at the beginning, I thought my assignment would last probably in between 3 to 6 months until I finished my learning in the U.S., interpreted in Japanese, and teach. To the my seniors, but once a company started, you are also assigned some type of a job, and that job is not really easy, and also it was very interesting to me as a young person like me, unexperienced, but I was assigned a little bit bigger role as a young staff, so I continued to stay until today. So it changed the entire my life by this assignment. What I studied at the University of Washington was a very peculiar field. I majored in foreign trade. That means I wanted to work outside of Japan and to do international business. But by this new assignment to the this new companies, my entire career is more domestic oriented business person, and I remained within Japan since that time until today. So I was lucky to be a member of a small venture business, and this company could become, they changed the name from original name of Orient Leasing Companies. Now it is called Orix Corporations. It become a full-fledged type financial service companies, having from a number of people, 13 to roughly now, probably 30,000 people working in 36 countries. So I experienced very interesting change of the time, and also the maybe evolvement of the new companies in Japan. So today, I would like to talk about the changes of Japanese economy in the last 50 or 60 years versus the changes changes of, at Orix from the perspective of the head of the companies for some years. Over nearly 55 years in the business, I have seen Japanese corporate sector evolved in many ways. During the high growth period, that is that lasted roughly 35 years, it was a risk-taking overachiever. But it has turned into the timid underachiever in the post-bubble years. We have created bubble in between, especially in between 1985 and 1990s. So underachiever always after 1990 until today. Now we are seeing the first signs of return to the intelligent risk-taking or good risks in my terms. These observations are based on my own experience through witnessing how a venture business that was founded 51 years ago on 1964 has successfully developed to the size it is now. Throughout the economic boom and bust, and the long stagnation that followed after, I was constantly in the position to think about how to run the company, how to steer the company's direction to be in line with the macro environment, or maybe even just to ignore the macro environment entirely and make my own decision. First, I'd like to touch upon the history of risk-taking in corporate Japan. Today, Japanese companies may have been have a kind of a reputation for being timid toward risk-taking. Many investors think this is characteristics of the Japanese mind or the national mentality. In fact, a look at the past shows this observation to be contrary to the truth. For instance, the title of the National Economic Report on the 10th year after the war ended, that is 1955, was long gone the post-war era. The following 35 years until 1990, Japan continued its astonishing hyper-economic growth. Just 10 years after Japan's complete economic collapse in the wake of World War II, no one would have thought that Japanese firm would dominate the steel, auto, and electronics industry by around 1980. But it happened. Such success would never have occurred if not for aggressive and intelligent risk-taking. In my view, the aggressive Japanese corporate approach to risk was a result of the macroeconomic environment post-World War II, up to around, as I mentioned, 1990. For instance, in 1955, real GDP per capita in Japan was only about US equivalent of $5,000 in today's prices. By 1973, that is 18 years after the 1955, the figure came to about US 18,400, posting an annual growth rate of 7.5%. Moreover, the volatility of growth was low. During these years, the GDP deflator, which reflects profits and wages, recorded an annual average of about 6%, also with very little volatility. Profit and wages were both increasing quickly, and the stock market rose by 1,000%. If you look at this chart, you can see the red color is real GDP per capita has been growing very rapidly at the rate of 9.2% annually up until 1973-4, when we had the first oil crisis. Then the following 15 or so more years, the growth rate has declined a little bit, but still maintained 4.1%. But at the time of the around 1990s, this is a post-bubble bust period, real GDP growth is remained and lowered to 1.1%. So you can see gradual decline of Japanese growth. But you may not be impressed very much about after bubble, post-bubble period, because looking at you are still growing like 1.1%. But if you remember, after the bubble burst, what the Japanese government did was they spent a lot of public funding to maintain the GDP of Japan, which created huge budgetary deficit. Now we are considering it a very serious problem. So Japan has been growing up until 1990. We had grown by our own aggressive, innovative movement to move the economy to the upward. Then in this macro environment of high growth and moderate inflation, the risk return balance was very good. And there was a lot of intelligent risk taking occurred. Corporate strategy was expansionist, driven by large investment and diverse product development. Also, research and development spending increased, and top-line growth, a global orientation, had taken place. It is important to note that among all the economic growth, the contribution from the private sector was enormous and dominant. During such period, various events took place. 1973-1979, we have two oil crises, certainly came as a shock to the economy. But the corporate risk-taking attitude and the global perspective did not weaken immediately. The world economy was still expanding. And Japan had always had an energy-efficient economy, so higher oil prices actually gave us some advantages on the world stage. Indeed, the share of Japanese cars in the U.S. auto market went from about 5% in 1970 to more than 20% in 1980. Over the three decades, from the late 1950s to 1990, the nation's record of continuous growth spoke for rare economic vitality. And behind this momentum were the aggressive risk-taking of the Japanese corporations. Then entered the 1980s with the increasing presence of Japan in the world economy. Especially the strong export sector has caused severe economic friction with the US and Europe. As a result, US and European countries began to demand structural reform of the Japanese economy and measures to boost the domestic demand instead of export-driven economy. The peak of all of these took place during 1985, where the Plaza Accord was signed. Japan had backed down to the strong pressures from the West by shifting its policy to strengthen the value of the yen and embarked on quantitative easing to boost domestic demand. This is the US dollar and Japanese yen exchange rate. If you look at February 1973, US float, first time float dollars, so that the Japanese yen appreciated quite a bit at that time. And at the time of Plaza Accord, that occurred September 1985. The yen has increased from 239 at September 85 to roughly 145. That occurred in 1987. So the Plaza Accord gave a fairly strong shock to the yen's appreciation. And since that time, yen is in between 150 up to 75.54 yen. That is the maximum yen could go in the past, is 3 years ago. That was September 31st of 2011. This is a dramatic change of the currency by the pressure from the west side to stimulate domestic demand. Japanese economy was expanded rapidly during that time when Japanese government proceeded to lower interest rate and commenced monetary easing. But what followed was the asset bubble and soaring real estate and stock prices. All these changes were brought between 1985 to 1990. If you look at this chart, you will see this is a red is a price of Nikkei 225. Blue line is a stock market capitalization of Tokyo Stock Exchange. So you can find out end of the 1989, that is the highest. This is the end of the December. We recorded 38,915 yen. It is the highest at the Tokyo Stock Exchange average prices. Due to this bubble burst, price went down more than half, and today's price is just around 20,000 Nikkei Dow. And blue line, if you look at the capitalization, market capitalization of those listed company is up and down and has not grown in the last more than 20 years. So stock price is much miserable, but at the same time, if you look at this increase of capitalization of the company is still remained up and down and has not shown any sign of growth in the last 20 years. As the asset bubble has reached a tremendous scale, the government implemented a policy to crush the asset bubble and try to turn it back to the level as it was before. Then the economy took a sudden turn into the long and dark period of recession. The bubble economy had made many of them self-satisfied and complacent. But when the bubble burst, the pendulum swung the other way, just as behavioral economies teach. After you have taken a risk and lost, you become excessively risk averse. Then the negative spiral may come about. When you don't take appropriate risks, you underperform. When you underperform, you take even less risks. It is hard to escape from such a vicious circle, and this is exactly what happened in Japan after the collapse of the bubble. I observed that the macroeconomic policy of the Japanese government at that time was a big mistake. Moving too quickly to undo the bubble excesses, macro policy led to deflation. 20 years between 1993 and 2013, per capita real GDP growth was only 0.8% annually. And the GDP deflator, which measures price changes in current year, compared to those in the base year, followed by also 0.8% per year. By the mid-1990s, Japanese companies' mentality had changed completely. As they became very risk-averse, the focus shifted to small investment, narrow product lines, cost-cutting, local market, restructuring, and domestic orientation. Individual employees focused on avoiding mistakes, and eventually they will become less motivated to set high goals. Now, after 20 years of deflation, the mindset of risk aversion has been deeply ingrained. A whole generation of workers and managers have grown up with deflation and risk aversion programmed in their mind. In contrast, however, the job of the business manager should be to take good risks, to run business innovatively, and ultimately create new value for the society. Under the long period of deflation, cost cutting tend to be the easier way to create immediate result rather than making more forward-looking moves. Then a new breed of managers have appeared on the scene. They are extremely good at cost cutting, eliminating unnecessary research and development expenses. They are talented making restructuring, separating underperforming divisions, implementing selection and concentration strategies, and so on. All these strategies have nothing to do with the innovation. In fact, cost cutting, if you look at it from a macroeconomic perspective, it reduces the overall size of the economy. To reverse the impact of these years, it will take a major change in the environment. And that is where Abenomics comes in. Prime Minister's Abe's economic plan is called Abenomics. This plan for the economy is often described as three arrows. The first arrow involves an aggressive monetary policy that seeks to achieve 2% level inflationary trend. The second arrow is a flexible fiscal policy that aims to get people to spend more money until deflation is defeated. The third arrow is growth strategy or structural reform, targets productivity growth. This all sounds very macro, but in fact, I think it is quite micro in many aspects. With the Bank of Japan's unprecedented aggressive policy, market expectations have gradually shifted from deflation to inflationary trend. This policy has been implemented in two phases. First, Mr. Haruhiko Kuroda, governor of the Bank of Japan, surprised the world with its new monetary easing measures, both quantitative and qualitative, immediately after he assumed his office. Second, the Bank of Japan introduced even more dramatic monetary easing on October 31st of the last year. The combination suggests that Abenomics' first arrow essentially is made of two arrows. Since deflation is one of the key reasons that corporations have become so risk averse, its end should help to restore risk taking. Now, 2 years have passed since the start of Abenomics. It is evident that the risk averse mindset of Japanese companies have started to gradually change. Some of these are, one, people think that deflation has ended. Future prospect looks better. It is time for us to grow our top line instead of cutting costs. Two, The period of strong yen is over. Domestic production should suffice to meet the output need. Some domestic manufacturers focus on building factories within Japan, while Japanese unique service providers and retailers, such as a company like Uniqlo and many convenience stores, tend to expand globally. It goes to show that there seems to have been realization that the management style until now is no longer appropriate under the current environment. It also seems like Japan is at a point of divergence right now. As you may have already noticed, such diverged outlook has already been reflected on stock market. Japanese stock market has made remarkable recovery in the last 24 months. This chart is a comparison of the stock market in various places. The red top line is Japanese stock market. We put the base year at April 2013, just two years ago. And we compared Nikkei 225, New York Dow, and FTSE, that's in London, and DAX, this is Germany stock market. Japanese stock market showed the highest growth in the last 2 years, reaching roughly 160% compared with the 2 years before, followed by the German stock exchange. For instance, FTSE, London Stock Exchange, remained very low growth in the last 2 years. So in the macro phase, we already seen some reflection of new policies, especially in this stock market. And also, we are seeing some reflection in the real estate market in Tokyo and metropolitan area of the other big cities. But people are, because of their last experience, are very keen about this might not be creating another bubble or not. So I think we are seeing some very cautious move, and careful watch is taken by the government. I hopefully severe views from them. Now I would like to talk about a company I worked for during this 35 years of growth and 20 some years of stagnations. In the middle of all these major economic events, as I mentioned, in 1964, a small equipment leasing company, now called Orix, with a small capital, as I mentioned, of 100 million yen, was established. In the beginning, the economy was, as I mentioned, expanding at that time, and the company, small company, had to deal with a funding shortage all the time. Fortunately, this small financial service company had somehow managed to secure just enough funding to keep growing. Then competition gradually intensified as more and more competitors start to enter this market. In response to this, the company's management made several important strategic decisions. First was to diversify into the other business. Second is to expand into the overseas market, especially in Asia. And third is break free from the parent company and aiming for public listing. Especially if you are created by the big corporation, you will find out lots of influence from the parent company, so that our management at that time wanted to be free from those interference and the only way is to go public. It was when the company started to adopt these new strategic directions, I became a member of the management team. And in 1980, I became a head of the company and have since run the company based on the same principles. On the back of strong economic growth, this basic principle and each specific strategy derived from it have together contributed to the company's growth. Up until the collapse of the bubble economy, despite the up and downs along the way, the company has basically kept growing together with the Japanese economy. During the early stages, innovation was the only way for such a small company to grow. Besides, diversification itself entails taking on various new challenges. Among them, despite the many failures that we had, we are basically able to identify such failures early on. What we had to do was minimize the losses and shift the majority of our resources to new businesses that had better prospect to succeed. Such approach worked and enabled us to successfully diversify our business portfolio to the extent today. We took two major strategies to extend our business domains. First, we followed the basic principle of diversification, which is extending our business to the area that lies next to our core business domain. At the same time then, we used mergers and acquisition to obtain experience and know-how in the moment. Regarding how we weathered the bubble economy, fortunately, we detected potential risks associated with it early on, and we started taking various initiatives to minimize losses, especially of our real estate financial business. At the same time, we recorded impairment and amortized our asset also early on. In the end, these early moves enabled us to differentiate significantly from other banks and financial institutions. Aftermath of the collapse of the bubble economy took its toll on the company's performance for several years. Japan had experienced most difficult macroeconomic situation during around 1997 to 1998. However, Orix, our company, had already recovered before this difficult time and went on to be listed on the New York Stock Exchange in September 1998, while many other Japanese financial institutions went out of business. I still remember how many people in this country reacted with a surprise at the listing of Japanese financial institutions on the New York Stock Exchange during such a turbulent time. Looking back, during good times, we had enjoyed our success together with a favorable macro environment. And during a difficult time, when the macro environment was sluggish, through our own initiatives, we managed to minimize losses. Even in the deflationary economy, we have been able to achieve extremely stable growth through our diversified business in Japan, and also to transform the company to the multinational one. Now, as I mentioned, we have covering 36 countries and regions worldwide. When the Lehman crisis erupted, it was also a big event for the for us. It caused a significant impact to the business community worldwide, and also Orix was no exception. We managed to remain profitable while most of our peers were either scrambling for government support or simply gave up and forced bankruptcy. within the financial service industry, considering how many companies that went down, our case of surviving through such a difficult time on our own without relying upon the government nor other major business groups was an exceptional one indeed. As a result of what we have been through for the fiscal year ended this year, this March, we are going to make a public announcement soon. As previously estimated, we are now targeting the net income of 251 billion yen. That is equivalent of the 1.8 billion US dollars after tax income, which, if achieved, means a new record high in the company history. The lesson for us was that despite a deflationary economy, as long as we pursued cross-border expansion and diversification of our business, opportunities will be limitless for the company like our style. Also, we have learned how important it is for managers to be forward-looking and pursue innovations and avoid falling into backward mentality, such as focusing on cost cuttings. Perhaps the fact that I have been running the company almost single-handedly until recent time has helped to sustain the consistency of company's strategy. This situation established credibility for the company as well from the outside world. What I can say after my long term as a management and my direct experience with the economics up and downs is that a company, no matter how difficult the macro environment may be, for example, deflation, the economy and the potentials it provides to its participant is enormous, limitless. Even in a deflationary economy, there's always a huge market providing new frontiers for every company to challenge. Companies tend to be encouraged by favorable economic conditions, but they often fail to recognize that a difficult economic environment does not always affect companies badly right away. The companies are able to avoid negative effect from economic downturn with an appropriate management strategy. Therefore, there's no reason why companies should adopt passive management style using unfavorable environment as an excuse. Unfortunately, it was the previous state of Japanese economy that lasted until quite recent times. Not to mention that any company has a right to compete in the global marketplace. Such market potentials and opportunities should be also limitless for the individual company. I think the Japanese economy has embarked on the path of change. The Japanese management is also changing now. Orix, I think, as long as we continue the way we have managed the business, regardless of how macro environment may be, we will continue to contribute to the overall economy. With this long-term perspective that I have just mentioned, I would like to continue to support the current management team in sustaining the company's growth in the future. I would like to close to my talk here, and I really appreciate the opportunity to present my experience to you, and I would like to receive any comment or questions you have, and I will try to answer those. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much. We do have time for questions, so if you do have questions, we have microphones, and we'll.
Thank you very much for your very interesting talk. I wondered if you could comment a bit about barriers to entrepreneurship. That is, what is discouraging Japanese from taking more risk? When I look at international data, Japan is the worst on fear of failure. It seems that failure is very heavily punished in Japanese society. So that might be one very natural reason why people don't take risk, because they're fearing failure. What are some other things? I mean, is it that Japan is so rich and people are so comfortable, so why bother with taking risks because I'm going to have a good life anyway? I mean, what are some other things that you think might be discouraging risk taking?
Well, I don't have a proper answer to your question, but what's happening in Japan is that maybe still best and brightest young people are not willing to go back to their back garage to start something else. Rather, they like to take a job at the government or at the big corporations. So new thing is happening within the big organization. So it's a very different point compared with the US. We have many entrepreneur type young people, but some of them are not well equipped with knowledge, expertise. They are not well educated. For instance, in this country, I mean, probably at the UW, you have entrepreneurship classes at business school. We don't provide those for the young people. So that without, even if young people are willing to do something new, they need help from other people. Unless otherwise, they would not succeed. So. I don't think we have, and also, most of the family have a small number of children, one or two, and they are educated as not taking any big risks. Especially mother is very kind enough to get good job at a big company. So I really, it's kind of a joke, but I really like to re-educate mothers of Japan.
You had the experience as a young man of managing a company through a period of tremendous growth. Now, then you hit the difficult times from 1985 on, but you had that early experience. As you think about handing the company on to a new generation of managers, that generation will not have had that experience of tremendous growth. Do you think you'll nonetheless be able to inculcate in that generation these same expectations that you brought, that this kind of growth is possible, or will the company be constricted by the experience of this new generation of managers?
It is also a very difficult question, because I finished my term as a CEO just June last year. Since that time, I put a new title of a senior manager, chairman. That is, nobody identified what kind of job I should perform. So I'm I'm watching very carefully what my successor is trying to do. And I'm actually trying to educate him and try to talk about my experience. Not only him, but also I am trying to educate the management team. Larger management team consisted by 30 people. So I'm having a special class for them and talk about all the stories to them. But I don't know if I can succeed in or not at this point.
Yes, I'm curious about financing entrepreneurship in Japan. I remember once I was in a conference in Canada, and Mr. Yen from Japan, the former finance minister, argued effectively that big corporations could provide both the financing and the incentive for innovation as easily as the American style venture capital, angel capital thing. And I was fascinated to hear how you pulled it off, starting with a big company and then making it. So two questions. One, would you comment on the venture capital situation and the impediment that might provide for innovation? And two, I'd be interested in what you did with Orix back when you quickly said, we managed to find the money. I'd like to know where you found it and whether that was a consequence of the big company or your ingenuity.
Japanese company always face a funding problem. And until recently, I think we need to have a good connection or a good relationship with the big lending institutions. But gradually, Japanese economy had formed a capital market. So at the time of, for instance, the Lehman crisis, our companies, maybe our peers in this country would be funding 100% from capital market. In our case, we funded roughly 50% from capital market and 50% from a lending institution. And after the Lehman crisis occurred, we found out capital market disappeared overnight. Then we cannot raise money in the commercial paper market. And also, corporate bond market also disappeared. So that 50% of our funding source disappeared. And so we needed to utilize our close relationship with the lending institutions. So we have a difficult time, but those lending institutions have been with us for the last 30, 40 years. They know this is an extraordinary period, so they did their best to maintain the relationship with good customers, including ourselves. That's why we could survive during Lehman crisis. Versus in these countries, when the capital market disappears, many companies, they didn't go bankrupt, but they tied with somebody else or asked for the help from the government. So we are fortunate that we couldn't So we are still maintaining a close relationship with the lending institutions. We are now fairly big borrowers. So for them, we are very important customers. At the same time, they may feel it is quite a risky customers in the future. So we are trying to get a very, very close contact with all the lending institutions. Closing carefully what we are doing, and have a good communication with the executives. That is a key for to avoid the real risks. At the same time, we try to maintain certain grade of the rating. So rating agents for us is also another important people to watch our companies. Soundness. We are taking a rating from two Japanese rating agencies and two maybe people are talking about return on equity is very low in the case of Japan. But for the manager of the company, ROE is not the only criteria of the value of the company. Rather, we need security of the company is also very important. So I always consider both rating and ROE are the two important criteria to run the companies. About the venture capitals in Japan have not succeeded in Japanese market yet. Their size is very, very small yet. And they are not very successful so far. But in the coming future, I think to foster those small venture business, we need to have more venture capital and more monies invested in this area. It's vital for the future of Japan. Your second question was on the... At that time, because we are fortunate at the initial stage, because the company was initiated by the five different banks. So they are the one who put up a small amount for this venture business, so that they are obligated to fund to some extent, small amount. That is the beginning of the business. Then we try to get a guarantee from our non-bank shareholders. They are the three trading firms. They are reluctantly guaranteed to our borrowing. But at the same time, we face lots of maybe interference or some maybe they have lots of management. We created lots of management problem with the shareholders. So with having a big companies as shareholders, you cannot grow as you should. So that management at that time made a very good choice, but at the same time it was very difficult for them to say goodbye to from the original shareholders, but they did it. And maybe as a young staff, I helped it. That is a very, very interesting story. But it,
in the United States, we like to talk about leadership traits. I wonder what you would consider the traits that you have as a leader that some of the rest of us might learn from. What made you successful as a executive and leader?
I'm not in the position to criticize the U.S. policy, but I feel that in this country, I think financial sector is so important, very important to grow U.S. economy further, and I think it continues to be important. That is quite different from the case of Japan. In case of Japan, financial institutions are always regarded as a supporter of the, especially manufacturing sector, supporter of the all other industries. So people in Japan do not believe that the financial sector will lead entire economy. That is maybe difference of the belief. It seems to me that in this country, I think the financial sector is really leading the entire economy.
Sorry, over here.
After you.
Oh, thank you. Do you find, since having been studying in the United States, specifically since Japan is, compared to, let's say, the United States or Europe, not so experienced to outside cultures and maybe not so ethnicity diverse, but having you studied in the United States, do you find that being exposed to cultures that are less risk averse has had a strong impact on your decisions to be less risk averse?
I don't know how I am created as I am now. Maybe I can tell two things. That is my experience at the time of war. at the time of defeat of Japan, back 1945, I was 10 years old boy. And I was living in the city of Kobe, where the, one of the big cities. And all Japanese cities, except for Kyoto and Nara, was bombed. Entirely collapsed. Everything disappeared. So I was forced to move to the countryside and had a really hard time. So I still, young boy, I could saw this miserable stage of Japan bombing. And Japan lost 3 million plus people by the war, and which include many, many civilian was dead. So around me, I was fortunate. I haven't lost any family member, but many friend of my lost one or two families by the bombing, and also the, by the war. So to me, I think this experience gave a strong impression. August of 1945, we declared we lost. And that is a summer vacation. And we hear Japan was defeated, and people are so disappointed. And well, 1 month later, the autumn session of the primary school started. And we found out teachers are so amazed about the fact, and they don't know how to teach the student. But before, they called US, UK, those are the enemies, and defeat them. Those are the slogan we used to hear from the teachers, and all of the teaching at the school was like a very military type education was. And in September, you found out General MacArthur is a great guy, and he's above emperor, and now the democracy and peace is the best. And so completely different education has started. So I had a big doubt about this power, or those. I couldn't trust the government at that time. This is a big experience to the small boy. Another experience is my study in these countries. As I mentioned, I found out Japan is not the center of the world atlas. It's a far end. You must look at it. And now I found out the Japanese population is 127 million people versus 7 billion people living on the earth. So I think we only have less than 2%. And at the same time, as you read the book of Crash of Civilization by Samuel Huntington, he divided the civilization of the world into the seven categories. And they assigned Japan as one of the seven. Only having less than 2% of the population of the world occupied one of seven civilizations. And he mentioned Japan is so isolated from others, and Japan created identical, very peculiar culture and civilization itself, and not much to do with China. So as a Japanese, I always feel that Japan has a lot of good things that we are willing to be utilized worldwide, but we need to have communication systems that, Japanese only speak Japanese, but the world and the global stage, you cannot use Japanese to the other people. The people in the other world would not learn Japanese to study Japanese culture and civilization. So I always think this is a time of communication. We need to learn English, and also we need to try to communicate what we have as a Japanese, and let other people to utilize this unique cultures for the other value. So I have two big experience myself, but I don't know how much portion of that has created me myself.
I'm embarrassed to ask this question after that one. Sir, with Orix being in as many sectors as it is, what's your read of the future of the power industry in Japan? Yes, sir.
Well, maybe I think population is a big thing. So as I mentioned, the Japanese population is very small. And if you be in Asia, we have a lot of big countries like China have a billion and four is a huge. And even a country like Indonesia now having 300 million people. Philippines is reaching to the 100. So Asia is creating many big powers. So among Asian country, what we should aim is we are not competing against those power game. Rather, we should create a very unique, quiet, and matured societies, and people maybe feel more, maybe happier than the maybe most of the other people in the other countries. So I think we should aim for to creating a better society and a comfortable life, and also very secured communities. Those should be the target for the Japan in the coming years. This is my very, very individual, I mean a personal opinion. Maybe Mr. Abe, I don't know if he would agree to me or not.
My question is about the business decision. Throughout the 50 years of position as CEO, what was the most difficult decision making you had to make?
I think you face a problem most of every day, and you tackle against those problems almost every day. So that even if the problem is small today, you must maybe you use 100% of your energy to solve this problem. Next day, you might face bigger problem. You again use 100% of your energies. So after you finish those things every day for the last 50 more plus years, it is very difficult which one is more difficult or not. I always think that to put my entire energy for the biggest problem in front of on my desk. So I do not have a long-term view. I do not try to draw some pictures in 10 years from now. I always face some question from my company's young staff that how I would think about 10 years from now, how you describe. I have no idea. But my aim is maybe tomorrow should be our company should be better than today. Day after tomorrow, we just like to create a better company than the previous day. Those are the target I have. Well, I'm sorry I break your some vision to me, but that is reality.
Okay. Okay, here. I am a Japanese student. I am thinking of creating my company when I go back to Japan. So I want to advice from you to make, as you have the experience of building a company, and you made it such a large company in this half century. So not only for me, but students here from Japan, would you give us advice?
I believe the things would never repeat. So nobody can repeat, try to repeat what I have done. So if I were you, I want to get a job at the big companies. Present the biggest company in Japan, will be not the biggest in the coming 10, 20, 30 years. So I will probably try to find out most prospective small company or start my own business. If I were young, I would do that. For instance, I have a son who also came to the UW and he got the MBA. So we are graduate of the same school, but he got the first job at the big financial institutions. And finally, he was recruited by a small company as an executive, but he was not satisfied with that. And he went self independent, and he started his own business. And I haven't helped him at all. One thing I told him when he was a small boy, one company you cannot get in is Orix. So remember this, we don't hire you. So this is our company's policies, to do not hire the family of the executives. So he knew, he know Orix very much. He always had the name. Repeatedly, so he loved Orix, but he know he cannot work with his father. So he started his own business, and luckily enough, his company went public a few months ago. So to some extent, it's a small scale. He is succeeding, I hope. So I really like to see more young people take interesting risk, because life itself is you are taking risk. Everybody is taking risk. Nobody knows what would happen for you, to you tomorrow. So living is risk taking. Why you cannot take risks in the business? It is much easier to me.
One last question.
Mr. Miyauchi, when in the 1980s, when I was teaching at University of Washington, you sent a number of your young managers to spend a year with some very clear goals as to what you wanted them to learn. And then you brought them into many of your international subsidiaries to almost immediately try to put those things to work in a multinational context. And you brought them back to Japan. But in the current environment in Japan, when everybody wants to come back to Japan almost immediately, is this kind of a model still there and for things in Japan? And do you think this is also a model that, as a business school professor, I should encourage my students to look for in their careers as well?
Very interesting question, because by the bubble burst days, many Japanese good companies select young staff, and they send to the U.S. business school. And those are the ones who are leading Japanese economy right now. But most of them, they are sent by the companies. And all expenses is borne by the company itself. But most of them, after they return to Japan, quit the company. So later years, many corporations, including Orix, found out it is a really expenses for the other companies. It looks very stupid. So I think many companies have stopped to do that. So nowadays, I think it is not company's expenses. If you find a business school student here, they are taking their own risks with the company, and they bear their own expenses to come over here and study seriously. So compared with those days, I think you are having a more decided young Japanese in your class.